Hey, this is Al Dawson from Earache Records, and we are actually celebrating our 30th year this year. So we're going to talk about some behind-the-scenes moments of some of the classic records that came out on Earache. I met Morbid Angel for the first time in 1989. I saw them play on the Grindcrusher tour, so I've known them, what's that, nearly 28 years or something, I think. Long, long time. And of all the different musicians that I've worked with over time, I've never met anybody else like Trey. Like, he is, you know, they say when they made so-and-so, they broke the mold. That is Trey. Like, he just marches to the beat of his own drums, completely out of his mind, but in the best possible way. Extremely creative guy, just never stops. And he's very, once he sits, he's into something, whether it's video games or BMX riding or martial arts, whatever, he's like 1,000% into it. That's, and you can see that's where his guitar playing comes from. But that said, you got someone like David, who in my mind is still one of the best death metal frontmen of all time. So having that combo of both of them is one of the reasons that they've been successful for so long. But I think too, if you look at, say, the other market leaders, so to speak, Deicide and Cannibal Corpse and all that, I think one of the reasons that Morbid Angel did do so well, they navigated the major label system, they had two records on Atlantic and survived that, was the fifth member of the band. Well, I call him the fifth member of the band, but their manager, Gunter Ford. They did a deal when we had our distribution deal with Columbia Records. He did a separate deal with Atlantic. And this is after grunge, and the major labels all thought, the indie record scene, we can make money from this, and we don't really get it, but let's pick up some of these guys and put some money behind them, and we'll see what happens. And he sat in a boardroom meeting with all these suit and tie guys, and they go, we got Morbid Angel, this is going to be the new Metallica, we're going to sell 2 million, no, we're going to sell 4 million, like 5 million records. And he's like, let me stop you there, I want you guys to market and budget accordingly, and just spend, to project to 200,000 and leave it at that. And that's unheard of for a manager, because most managers would go in and be like, spend, spend, spend. But you do that, the record company looks at it, a year later, so for our return on investment, we made a massive loss, drop the band or bury the band. Even worse than being dropped is you're stuck in major label limbo where you can't do anything. You know, the band went out and the record, I mean, they had tracks on Beavis and Butthead, and which is probably one of the only video outlets in America at the time, 94, 95. Plus the fact that I know so many people who discovered Morbid Angel through seeing the video played on Beavis and Butthead.
Bow to me.
Bow to me.
Bow to me faithfully.
Bow to me faithfully.
But because of that, they got to do a second record with the majors, which is, you know, as I said, most managers would not have the foresight to see that. They would be spend, spend, spend. So to me, he is definitely the secret sauce behind those guys, and something that has kept them going, you know, through the thick and thin, you know. For the Domination record, the standout track for most of us was Where the Slime Lives. We had seen years beforehand, Slayer did a blood pack edition, almost like the plasma bags you get in hospital or whatever when someone needs a blood transfusion. And it's, you know, it's basically slime, you know, that kid's toy in a plastic sealed thing. So we went to our pressing plant, we want to do green slime, you know, we'll do a slime pack edition of the record. All of the manufacturing plants in the UK are like, nope, we do not no longer do those, we won't touch it. Come on now, we don't accept no as an answer. So we started looking further and further afield, and perhaps at this point, I think maybe the internet was a thing, but it was phone book and calling people up and, well, who do you use and tell me the name of your plant. And perhaps Matt from Relapse had told us of a pressing plant that they use for novelty editions in the US. We called the guy up, we want to do a slime pack. He's like, okay, let me send you some samples. So he sends a couple of samples over and we get them, and sure enough, it's like the kid's toy slime in a sealed pack. And we're like, oh my God, this is amazing. And we're all playing with them on our desks and we're like, this is the one, we're gonna use it. So we ordered up, we like, make us 20,000 slime packs or whatever. And we had the packs printed in America and shipped to a CD pressing plant in the UK so that, you know, the workers could put them all together and send them out to the shops or whatever. So that's all going well. And then one day my production guy gets a call, he's like, what? No. And he hangs up and I'm like, what's up? And he goes, the workers at the CD pressing plant in the UK refuse to touch the slime packs. And it's like, why? It's slime. You're like, kids, it's a kid's toy. You know, sure enough, toddlers put it in their mouth and chewed on it as kids or whatever. It's fine, tell them to toughen up and get on with it and all this sort of thing. To show his workers, he had picked up a box full of the packs and was kind of leaking, and he'd held it against his sweater and said, look everyone, it's perfectly safe, and moved it across the room. He said the next day it was like the film Aliens. It had eaten away the sweater. Like it was like holes in it and that. And so of course the staff are completely freaked out. We're like, wow, that, whatever, get on with it and all this. Next thing you know, the fax machine, because that's what we had back then, starts whirring. And this guy's sending through this eight-page disclaimer. And it goes, warning, do not touch, you know, the slime or whatever. Slime could cause, you know, redness to skin, headaches. And it went on for 8 pages. And the final page is, ingestion could cause death. And we're like, what? And what had happened was, to save money on a custom shipment of 20,000, use like the kiddie slime, it's gonna be X amount of dollars, but if you substitute it for a cheaper, more toxic product, you could save himself another couple of grand in the deal or whatever. So the guy had put the more toxic slime in, so we had to dump them all. We had to get a hazardous waste guy come in and remove them all. Because it was that dangerous. I mean, we got a press story out of it, which was a small consolation or whatever. But I believe at some point, maybe Dig had saved like 5 or 10. So 5 or 10 exist somewhere in the world. But that was a packaging nightmare for Morbid Angel.